he may be taller than your neighbor. Lift your right hands to heaven, let's pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you for the privilege of coming before your world. Thank you that your people are already set to receive. So we receive from the excellent ministry of Jesus. And I decree right now, whatever is not planted by God is rooted. Every yoke is destroyed. Every body is terminated. Sickness and disease be healed. Build your people by revelation. Let the veils of darkness be destroyed. Equip your people and nobody lives here the same way they came. In Jesus' precious name. And every believer says a powerful amen. Lift your right hands to heaven. Let's release our faith together. As we say these words, I believe the word of God. It is final authority in my life. In spite of my circumstances. In spite of my situation. I believe the word of God. I am what God says. I am. I have what God says. I have. I can do what God says. I can do. I receive revelation. And I decree I will grow in knowledge. I will grow in grace. By the end of this house, I will never be the same again. In Jesus' name. Every believer says a powerful amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, we are excited to be back to Dubai, to be with you again in this house, God's pavilion. And you guys are really, really blessed. Because it's been a while and my family has not, we've not been in any church, anywhere around the world together. We're happy to be able to be together, you know, and the Triple J to be with us also in the service. I believe your ministry has blessed you. Hallelujah. I want to celebrate Pastor Fed and the First Lady of this house. We are very excited. That we are able to be with you again. Like I said the last time I came, the second way, the first one is the true nature of God revealed in Christ. The true nature of God revealed in Christ is a book that deals with the revelation of who God really is, not just rumor, contradictions, or what you think, but the true nature of God as it is revealed in Christ. In that book, I dealt with a number of issues that will help you understand who God is, the character of God, and how God operates. Because you cannot really walk with God until you know Him. Somebody you don't know, you can't believe it. You can't even pray well when you don't know something. You can't know Him to be able to believe it. So that book will help you a lot. And then I came with another book, a statue, Realities of the New Testament. Realities of the New Testament. It is a book that helps you understand the whole Bible in a glance, the whole Bible. You're able to understand the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament and all the realities in the New Testament as it relates to the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. The two books are here, very limited copies, because we're going to come with much. Make sure you get your copy today before you leave. Are you ready for the Word of God? Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 15 is my foundation scripture. The last time I was here, I remember that is where I started from. Yes. And I like to start from there so I can build on what I taught the last time I was here. So 2 Timothy, the Holy Scripture, is a Greek word for hagiography. It means sacred writings or set apart writings. That the scriptures are sacred or the scriptures are set apart. The scriptures are not a material like biology, science, and chemistry. They are set apart writings. So, from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, it means that the scriptures are not complicated. Even a child can know them, which are able to make thee wise unto unto salvation. That the mission of the scriptures is to bring you to a place of wisdom in the subject of salvation. The Bible speaking in Romans chapter 1 verse 16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. The scriptures are able to make you wise unto salvation. The mission statement of Jesus in Matthew says, she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Why? He shall save his people from their sins. So, the mission of Jesus is to say, the gospel is the power of God to salvation. The scriptures are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. That the biggest thing in the heart of God for mankind is salvation. Then the next verse says, all scripture, or the Greek word is pasagraphe. It means the entirety of the document called scripture is given by inspiration of God. It means God breathed out the scriptures. To inspire means to breathe out the scriptures. So God breathed out the scriptures, or the scriptures are given by the inspiration of God, and they are profitable. So he draws the modern line that the scriptures are profitable. Number one, for doctrine. The word doctrine means learning. The scriptures profit us in the area of learning. Number two, for reproof, that the scripture forms the basis for our conviction, or the basis for our evidence. They are given to us for evidence that no matter your experience, if it does not agree with the scripture, you've got to bring your experience under subjection to the obedience of the scriptures. Why? Because the scriptures is the final authority that forms the call for our evidence. The scriptures are also given to us for correction. That as you grow in grace and as you grow in knowledge, you will begin to see things the way you never saw them before. You must be flexible enough to allow the scriptures correct you. The scriptures profit us in the area of correction. They also profit us in the area of instructions within the framework of righteousness. The scriptures profit us from instructions in righteousness. Why? That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. That the mission of the scripture is to bring you to a place of perfection. The word perfect there means mature, maturity. That the man of God may be mature, decorated unto every good work. In John chapter 5 verse 39, Jesus speaking to the Jews said to them, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but the scriptures don't give eternal life. You think that the scriptures give eternal life, but the scriptures don't give eternal life. That's why you can sleep with your Bible under your pillow and Satan will slap you. It's not afraid of the Bible. Why? Because the Bible is not the word of God.
Wow.
That's why you can put the Bible in your car and have accidents. Because Satan is not afraid of the Bible. Some of you think because I have a Bible, Satan will fear me. No, he doesn't fear the Bible, because the Bible is ordinary paper and ink.
Yes, sir.
And the word of God is not paper and ink. John chapter 1 verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in darkness, and the darkness cannot handle it. Verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Verse 11. He came unto his own, and his own receiving God. Verse 12. But as many as received him, to them gave him power to become the sons of God. Verse 13. Which were born not of flesh, nor of blood, nor of the will of man, but of God. Verse 14. And the Word became flesh. The Word became flesh. The Word became flesh. The Word of God is flesh. The Word of God is not paper and ink. The Word of God is flesh. So, the Bible is not the Word of God. But you read the Bible to encounter the Word of God. Because the Word of God is a person. I don't know who I'm talking to here. I prophesy. Move to the next level. they testify of me. The scriptures are my testimonial. The scriptures forms my evidence. The scripture is my book. They don't give life, they testify. They are my testimony. In your own shatter. Verse 40. But you will not come to me that you may have life. That is the scriptures talk about me. But I give life. You cannot have life till you have me. Jesus said, I am the way. I don't have the way. The way is a person. So when I enter your heart, the way has entered. See, Jesus cannot be in you and you're looking for the way. He is the way, not a way. The way always are in him. When you have him, you have the way. Am I talking to someone? From today, your confusion is over. Of life in a birth, it was an existence. Actual birth is when you were resurrected by the death of Christ. It is called regeneration. It is called born again or born anew or born from above. That's the meaning of born again. It means God conceived you and pushed you out in Christ. That means the DNA of God is in you. What cannot attack God cannot attack you. Whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. Somebody shout, I am born of God.
Yes.
Whosoever,
yes.
Your village shall be saved. Your family background now will serve you. Once you are born of God, what happened to your father cannot happen to you. Once you are born of God, there is no generational curse. No ancestral curse. No generational curse. No, it does not exist. Sorry, chapter here. Say that, listen. Kambota, Kambota. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10. We are his workmanship. Created in Christ Jesus. The word created means never existed. When something is created, it doesn't have a past. The day you were born again was the day you were created. Look at it. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. We were created. To fabricate you. You are his handiwork. Watch this very carefully. The material that was used in fabricating you was sourced out of Christ. God took the very material in Christ. He brought out material from Christ to form the new man. The new man is not dying. The God that he came out of Christ, watch this, not the incarnate Christ, but the resurrected Christ. There is an incarnate Christ, and there is the resurrected Christ. Two of them are not the same. The incarnate Christ had to be anointed. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Acts 10:38. The risen Christ doesn't need to be anointed. The risen Christ is the anointer. He's the one anointing. The incarnate Christ had to be anointed. Are you with me? As the incarnate Christ, there was one miracle he could not perform. He performed all miracles minus one. Raised the dead, walked on the water, turned water to wine, commanded the fish to bring out money. There's no miracle he didn't need. He walked on the sea, rebuked the tsunami, stopped the wind, stopped the waves. They stopped him to pay tax. He said, a fish will give you the money. Even fishes were producing money. Fishes became central banks. From today, you will not lack. If your enemy is out, the supply is coming. Thank you. not of this earth. That's why it says you are in this world, but not of. Not of. Not of. That's to say, the material used to fabricate you was not sourced here. It was sourced from above. And not just from above, from Christ. You are Christocentric. What cannot attack Christ cannot attack you. Christ cannot have accident. You cannot have accident. Christ cannot be admitted in the hospital. You cannot be admitted in the hospital. Somebody say, yeah, here.
Yes.
The born of the incorruptible seed, which is the word of God. You came out of Christ, created in Christ. You are that manifestation of the third Adam, which is the last Adam. You are from above. And he that is from above is above all. Somebody shout, I hear you. Philemon 1:6. That the communication of your faith may be effectual. The communication of your faith may be effectual by the acknowledging. That word acknowledge is the Greek word epignosis. By the epignosis. Epignosis means accurate, precise, definite, exact, revealed knowledge. Not trial and error. Exact knowledge, revealed knowledge, epignosis. That was the prayer of Paul for the church in Ephesus. Ephesians 1:16. I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. What prayer? That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of revelation and wisdom in the knowledge of him, the epignosis of him. In the epignosis, not just in knowledge, but in the knowledge of Christ. Not in the knowledge of how many demons are in your family. In the knowledge of Christ. Stop seeking for knowledge outside Christ. It corrupts.
For sure, sir.
Stop trying to find out who is after you. Stop trying to find out how many enemies you have. That is useless knowledge. You should seek for the knowledge of Christ in Abota, because the knowledge of Christ is the accurate knowledge of the identity of the believer.
For sure, sir. That's for sure.
If you don't know Christ, you don't know you. So anybody can label you. Some of you are carrying people's labels. Failure. Stupid man, idiot, failure, and then you have accepted it. I know myself, nothing works. Before I get something, I have to struggle. That is somebody's label. They have put a label on you, and the reason why you have accepted that label is because you don't know yourself. So any label they give you, I know myself, every January I must be sick. I know myself, that's a label. They have given you and you have accepted the label. I know myself, things don't come easy. Before they come, that's a label. They gave you and you have accepted it. Some of you, they say you are a sanguine. You have accepted it. Some of you, they say you are an introvert. You have accepted it. Some of you, they say you are an extrovert. You have accepted it. All those are wrong labels. But because you don't know yourself, and so any name they call you goes. When you don't know your name, any name is your name. Jacob, yes sir. Idiot, yes sir. Stupid, yes sir. The knowledge of Christ is the unveiling of the identity of the believer, because the believer is in him. If any man be where? Where is the believer? You are not in Dubai. You are not in Dubai, you are in Christ. So if things are tough for people in Dubai, things cannot be tough for you, because When you don't know where you are, you won't know what you have. When you don't know what you have, you won't know what you can do. It is who you are that reveals where you are. It is where you are that reveals what you have. It is what you have that reveals what you can do. So it begins with who are you? Who are you? You are the believer in Christ. You are in Christ. You are His workmanship, created where? In Christ. You are in Christ. Let me ask you, is there cancer in Christ? You cannot have cancer. The X-ray machine cannot detect you. Even when they put the machine on you, it cannot see you. You know why? You are in Christ. X-ray machine cannot locate Christ. So if that X-ray machine cannot locate Christ, it cannot locate you. So any report it is showing, it is the report of the doctor, not your report. Because the doctor's hand is on the machine. The only person that the machine can read is the doctor. Because for you, the machine cannot find you. Because you are in Christ. I don't know if I'm teaching here. Psychologists cannot locate you. Philosophers cannot describe you. Where you are, mortal eyes cannot see. You are in Christ. That's where you are. But you must have a big nose, the accurate knowledge, that the eyes of your understanding be enlarged. The greatest prayer of Paul for the church is not that you may have, is that you may know. I was in London last week, and somebody asked me, a pastor's wife said to me, Papa, I said, yes, she said, what about a lady that is believing God for the fruit of the womb, and somebody that is believing God for a job? What kind of prayer should they pray? Give me the scriptures. I said, it's not about scripture. We're not in a formula.
It's not a formula?
No, these things are not formulas. Many of you are looking for formulas. There are no formulas in God. God, Jesus didn't come to give us formula. No. He didn't come to give us formula. He came to establish a relationship. It's not about scriptures. Because many people come to church because they have problems. They want God to solve their problem. You don't need church. There are native doctors solving problems. The reason why we come to church is to have a relationship with God. It's not for problem. Because you see, when you and God have a relationship, then everything that is God's becomes yours. As the relationship gets stronger, you can now begin to partake. You didn't hear what I said. Jesus didn't come to give us formulas. No, he came to establish a relationship. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, Jesus speaking said, after these things do the Gentiles seek. Take no thought what you shall eat, what you shall wear, what you shall drive, where you shall live. These are the things unbelievers look for. You shouldn't be looking for it because you are not an unbeliever. Unbelievers look for things. Therefore, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Next verse. Consider, 26, behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? The birds don't go to work, yet they lack not. Some of you are walking, you still lack. The lilies don't go to work, but every day they are watered, sun is shining on them. Are you not better than birds and lilies? If your Father is taking care, what makes you think you have to fast and pray for God to solve your problem? What makes you think you have to beg and beg and beg like an orphan for God to answer your prayer? If He takes care of the lilies and the birds without them even asking, without them even knowing, and you are of more value than them, Jesus is in introducing the concept here that relationship with God is the answer to all things. That once you and God have a relationship, you don't have prayer requests. All your prayer requests become thanksgiving. I'm teaching good. Next verse, 27. Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? Next verse. And why taking thought for clothes or raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. They don't walk, they don't labor, they don't struggle. Next verse. And yet I say unto you, even Solomon in all his glory was not as decorated as the lilies in the field. Next verse. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Why are you trying to make God like a wicked person? The brothers and the ladies don't pray. They don't fast. Yes, Solomon, with all his glory. You know the glory of Solomon? When the Queen of Sheba came from the gate, she collapsed because of the glory of Solomon. And the Bible says, even Solomon is not as decorated as the birds and the leaves. Then he said, how much more? Next verse. Therefore, take no thought, saying. Somebody say, I will not take thought.
I will not take thought.
You take no thought. How do you take thought? You take thought when you say, oh, how will I make it? Oh, things are tough. Oh, when will I arrive? Oh, how can I pay my house rent? Oh, when you start talking like that, you're taking thought. And he said, don't take thought. Take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what in that shall we be clothed? Next verse. For after all these things do the unbelievers seek. That's what they look for. And if you look for it, it means you have classified yourself as an unbeliever. After these things do the Gentiles, for your heavenly Father, not uncle. Your heavenly Father, not uncle. Not cousin. Somebody say relationship. Your heavenly Father knoweth. He doesn't need to be told. If you don't need to pray to remind him, he knows. And he's a responsible Father. Your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. So it's not your prayer that is making God answer you. He is not waiting for your prayer. Pastor Fed, your daughter does not need to pray for food. Your daughter wakes up and says, I'm hungry. Mommy said, you wait for 5 minutes, your food will be ready. The child does not care how you get the food, but the child knows that the way you look, you must know how to make food at home. Your child does not fast and pray for school fees. I never see the child come home, Mommy, I'm not going to eat today. Why are you not eating? I'm fasting. For what? School fees. School fees, you will slap that child. Because that child is trying to say you are irresponsible. It has to fast for you to think of school fees. The child doesn't need to fast. The child knows that once it is time, daddy, school fees will come out. Because daddy is responsible. If you on earth are that responsible, how much more your Father, which is in heaven? Am I teaching somebody? If you understand, they shall hear you. In Nigeria, we call it jar or add something. The one they add is not the one your money bought. The one they add is free. Additions are free. So God is saying, If you and me can have a good relationship, everything in this world will be free.
Amen.
You won't work for it. You won't struggle for it. You won't fast for it. You will be sleeping, somebody will give you a car. You will wake up in the morning, somebody will give you a house. In this Dubai, somebody will look at you and say, I like you. Take that mansion. Take that house. Top it up for business. If you are there, it's how the angels are arranging it. Somebody shout, I have God. I have everything. See that Romans 8:32. His own son. Let me ask all of you a question in this house. Jesus and car, which is more expensive?
Jesus.
Jesus and money, which is more expensive?
Jesus.
Jesus and house, which is more expensive?
Jesus.
He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us some things? Not some things. House, no car. Car, no house. Wife, no children. Children, no wife. Admission, no school fees. School fees, no admission. Is it will be given free. That means you won't fast for it. You won't pray for it. You won't cry for it. You won't beg for it. If it just come, you wake up, you sleep, you're dreaming, somebody wake up, money. You're taking coffee in the morning, somebody will come, king of a car. You're trying to go to work in the afternoon, somebody will call you a house. And people ask you, how is it working? Tell them I'm in relationship. I'm in relationship with the owner of the planet. The earth is the Lord's. And the fullness thereof. So the earth is mine. The earth is mine. The earth is the Lord's. And the fullness thereof. So the earth is mine. Somebody say, I'm a son. I'm not a slave. I'm not a servant. I'm a son of God. Born of God. I have the life of God. The righteousness of God. The light of God. The holiness of God. Is on my inside. God cannot say no to God. Cannot say no to me. God owns the world. Galatians 4:4. Thank you, Lord. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law. Next verse. To redeem them that were under the law. Why? That we might receive the adoption of sons. That means a son is not under the law. You cannot be a son under the law. Under the law are servants. So, people that were under the law were servants. Elijah was a servant. Jeremiah was a servant. Ezekiel was a servant. Moses was a servant. All of them were servants. So when Jesus came, he came under the law to redeem us from under the law so that we will no more be servants. Us as sons. The word adoption there means placement. It's not adoption that go to hospital and carry a baby. No, 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 no. scriptural understanding, adoption means God has placed you in a place where you are now a son with full rights and privileges. The adoption of sons. I'm a son of God. I'm not a servant of God. I'm a son of God. That means whatever God owns, I own. Your son owns your property. Everything you have is your son. The moment you die, your son takes over ownership. You are a son of God. When Jesus died, you took over ownership. You didn't get what I said. Jesus is no more here. He died and left here so that all the sons can wake up and take ownership. The whole creation has been waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. Why? Because the sons of God were subject to vanity. Why? They lack knowledge. So as this epignosis is coming, sons have been unleashed. You're coming out of shackles. You're coming out of bondage. You're coming out of ignorance. And you are now knowing who you are. So you're occupying your place in destiny. You're exercising authority. And you're walking in the full regalia of the glory of God. Shall I hear you? Sit down, Esther. Sit down.
Thank you, Papa.
What am I teaching here? Romans chapter 8 verse 14. I'm trusting God for when I can come to Dubai, we do 5 days. They teach you that you have the human spirit and then the Holy Spirit. That's not correct. You can't carry two spirits. You and God are one. You and God are one spirit. That is the spirit in God is the spirit in you, making two of you one. You don't have your own spirit and then God has his own spirit and then the spirit of God is trying to talk to you. The Holy Spirit is the same in you and in God. What makes you born of God is Holy Spirit. See that, listen. He is God, the Creator, in the Old Testament. In the Gospels, He is Christ, the Redeemer.
Amen.
When He died and rose, He is the Holy Ghost, the Regenerator. The same God. In the Old Testament, He is God, the Creator. Then when He wanted to relate with man, he stepped down. Because if He remains God, you can't approach Him. If He remains God, you can't reach Him. If He remains God, you can't try Him. So He stepped down, and stepping down made Him Christ Jesus. Because He's the same God. Jesus is God, I am my Father. So He now appear as Christ the human, so that man and God can relate. Because the mission is relationship. That's the mission, relationship. It's all about relationship. So since He wants to relate, He has to step down and be a man to relate. But as a man, He is limited. He can only be in one place at one time. It will be too slow for Him to reach everybody. So when He died, He rose. No more as Christ in relationship, but as Holy Ghost in regeneration, so that He can be in everybody, everywhere at the same time. everybody at the same time. Still the same God at work. If you understand that, say I hear you. So now you are a son of God by regeneration. Regeneration means you are regened. Regened. You know genetics. You are regened. There's a regene. That's to say the DNA of your father in the village is no more in your body. There's a regene of you. It's called regeneration. The word regeneration means regene or regenealogy. Regenealogy. That means your genealogy has changed. You are not from the family of Chibuzo anymore. There's a change of regenealogy. So I kill Chibuzo, I cannot kill you. Because something has broken the connection. Am I talking to somebody here? So that is why you are born of God. The life of God works in you. Say, I hear, I hear. Put it back. Romans chapter 8, verse 15. Verse 15, brother. Verse 15. For you have not received. Somebody say, I have not received. The spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Listen carefully. The born again man does not cry Jehovah Jireh. The born again man does not cry Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Shalom, Elohim, Yahweh, Adonai, El Elyon, Sidkenu, Shama. No, we don't cry that. That is the cry of servants. The spirit of sonship cries, Abba. Some of them saw him as Yahweh. Some of them saw him as Sidkenu. Some of them saw him as Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah El Elyon, Jehovah Adonai, Jehovah Sidkenu, and all the Jehovahs. Is because the Old Testament was a progressive revelation. Progressive, progressive, progressive. In the New Testament, we have full revelation, complete. So as they are progressing in the revelation of God, they were seeing him in different aspects. And whichever aspect of God they experienced, they gave it a name, Jehovah-tis. Jehovah-tis. When Jesus came, Jesus never called his father Jehovah. All the time Jesus spoke to the Father, he said, Father, I thank you. He called him Father. Father, I thank you that you hear me always. When he came to the tomb of Lazarus, Father, I thank you that you hear me always. I'm not doing this for you, but for these that are looking, that they may know that me and you have spoken. Lazarus, when he came to the place of bread, he didn't call him Jehovah. He said, Father, thank you for this bread. He gave them, said, give them to eat. As he broke it, he multiplied. Jesus never called his father Jehovah. He called his father. When you got born again by the Spirit of Christ, you two are not supposed to know Jehovah. You are supposed to know Father. You know what? When you say Father, in that word Father, there is Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah El Elyon. That was my secret. The spirit of adoption. I'm teaching. Now, put out the next verse as I round of this. Are you blessed?
Yes.
Verse 16. Watch this. This is going to be the explosion point. The spirit itself bears witness in our spirit that we are the children of God. Can you feel it inside?
Yes, sir.
You feel that peace?
That's right.
Some say I'm a child of God. Some say I'm a son of God. I'm a child of God. When you say I'm a child of God, it doesn't mean you are an infant. It means you came out of God. It doesn't mean age. Because some people used to say, when you are born of God, you are a child. Then when you grow, you are a son. It's illiteracy. Haven't you seen when they are doing burial? They will say, this man, 120, died. He is survived by children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. And among the children, one is 90 years. They don't call him son. They call him child. Because all of them came out of God. So we say you are a child. But what we're saying is you came out of God. But when you came out as a son.
Yes, sir.
I'm communicating that. It's not like you're born as a child, then you have to grow. Man, when you are born a son with the full regard of sonship. The only thing is that you don't know. That's why you come to church for teaching. We teach you to know who you are, so that you remove your own label and wear the right label. Yes. Let us say you are a sanguine. Is it sanguine?
Yes.
Or melancholy? Or whatever. When they give you all that title, you take it off and say, no, I'm not a melancholy. I'm not a sanguine. I'm not an introvert or extrovert or whatever. I am a new creation. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. You know what that means? It means nobody can identify you.
Yes.
Only God. So as many as are led by the Spirit are the children of God. Now watch the next verse. You will love this. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. You know what it means to be a joint heir? The word heir means owner. Me and God, we are co-owners. We don't own the world 50-50. We own the world 100-100. I'm not a co-heir. I'm a joint heir. That is me and God. We are joint. We work together as colleagues. We own the whole world together. If God say, I own the diamonds. Me too, I own the diamonds. If God say, I own the oil wells. Me too, I own the oil wells. If God says, I own all the gold mines. Me too, I own the gold mines. If God say, I own the world. Me too, I own the world. We are joint heirs. God is not superior and an inferior. No. Me and God, we are joint heirs. Whatever God can do, I can do. Whatever God cannot do, I cannot do. He cannot fail, I cannot fail. He cannot be sick, I cannot be sick. He cannot be broke, I cannot be broke. He's righteous, I'm righteous. He's holy, I'm holy. He is blessed. Is anybody here born of God?
Yeah.
I prophesy the next 30 days of your life, miracles. Yeah. Signs, wonders, good things, favors, increase, enlargement. If you stand up and shout out, receive it now. Whatever you've been trying to do in Dubai that has stopped working the last many years, within the next 30 days, receive it by favor. Receive it by favor. Of every good thing that is in you. in Christ. Listen carefully. There's nothing bad in you. The only thing in you, they are all good things. So a good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, bringeth forth good things. That means from now, you say it the way you want it, and you will see it.
Yeah.
You wake up in the morning and say, the champion is awake.
Yes.
This day,
yes,
everything is working for me.
Yes.
Somebody say, I hear it. Say, I am the prophet
of my life.
My prophecy will bring profit. I prophesy.
I am blessed.
Beyond the cost. I cannot be cost. I am in Christ. Only good things are in me.
I
didn't hear your amen. Look at right hand as I pray. In the name of Jesus, I declare for everyone under the sound of my voice, from after this service, what was not working is working. Blessed.